Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service of worship this morning. We're so glad that you are here to join us. If you're visiting with us today, we consider you honored guests. Thank you so much for being a part of this. If you have not yet been made to feel welcome, give us a minute. We'll have our greeting time, and we'll make sure that you are welcome this morning. I'm going to share with you some announcements so you know what's going on in the life of our church. And while I do that, if you would, you'll find red pew pads on the end of each row. Take those, fill out that registration for us. It's a good communication piece for us. You'll see it on the seats there on the end of each row. Fill that out, pass it down for all your neighbors to have. All right, announcement-wise, we've got several things going on. I'm not going to read everything, but I do want to highlight some of these things here. Children's Ministry upcoming events, Club 118 for 4th, 5th, and 6th graders is taking place today from 4 to 5:30 at the Siler Home. They have a time of fellowship. They work on a mission project. They have a devotional and eat pizza. Next Sunday is our trunk or treat. Our parking lot will be filled with all manner of folks. And so that's taking place from 4 to 6 p.m. If you have a trunk and would like to decorate it and pass out candy and do a game with the kiddos, we would love to have you participate with that. You can talk to Deirdre about that and give her a call this week, and she would be glad to get you set up. Now, if you don't have a game for the kids to play, but you do want to come with a decorated trunk, then don't worry about that. Deirdre can help you find the game that you need. All right. Next Sunday is our combined worship service. So that changes our schedule next Sunday. We need to be aware of this. Next Sunday, we'll have one service. It will be over in the Family Life Center at 10 a.m. And we try to do this about once a quarter on our regular ones. So what that means is 8:30 is our fellowship time, so you can have coffee and donuts in Harper Hall. 9 o'clock will be our Sunday school hour next week, and 10 o'clock will be our combined worship service over in the Family Life Center. So please be aware of that. There actually is another one coming up next month, and I'll explain why here in just a minute. Fifth quarter for our high schoolers. If you're a high school student, I want to hang out in the Family Life Center after this Friday's football game. That's going to be going on in our gym. And so tell your friends, tell your neighbors, and all that kind of good stuff. This is something for the high school students after the football game. And there'll be snacks and games and good times together. So there is a QR code in the bulletin for you to register for that. God is doing a new thing, stewardship. That's coming up. I'll tell you more about that a little bit later on in the service, about the theme for that and all that. But that is where we're going to be having a combined service on November the 12th. As I said, I'll tell you more about that here in just a few minutes later on in our service. Methodist Women, Wednesday, November 1st. We'll be meeting at 10 a.m. in the parlor. And then Methodist Men, this inadvertently got left off, Methodist Men are going to be meeting this Tuesday at 6 p.m. at Milano's Pizza. We take the community room there. So if there's any fellows in the church that wants to have a time of good fellowship, eat some good food together, and enjoy each other's company, you're invited to join us on Tuesday, 6 p.m., Milano's Pizza. All right, there's other things in there. There's a bingo day coming up. There's our next potluck with a purpose. There's other things in your bulletin. Just be sure to take that home with you. We would appreciate that. Okay, anything else? Anything I missed? If not, then let us stand and greet one another. Make sure our neighbors feel welcome.
Majesty, worship. worship His majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flow from His throne unto His own, His anthem raise. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Jesus the King, Majesty, worship His Majesty, Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Please remain standing for our call to worship.
The Lord reigns, let the nations tremble. He sits enthroned between the cherubim. Let the earth shake. Great is the Lord in Zion. He is exalted over all the nations. Let them praise your great and awesome name. He is holy. You may be seated as we prepare our hearts for worship.
Will you stand with me, please, as we sing Take Time to Be Holy.
Take time to be holy, speak oft with thy Lord. Abide in Him always and feed on His word. Make friends of God's children, help those who are weak. Forgetting in nothing His blessing to seek. Take time to be holy, let Him be thy guide, and run not before Him whatever betide. In joy or in sorrow, still follow the Lord, and looking to Jesus, still trust in His word. Take time to be holy, be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each motive beneath His control. Thus led by His Spirit to fountains of love, thou soon shalt be fitted for service above.
You may be seated for children's time.
Uh-huh. to be like dressed.
Okay. All right. So I'm dressed up like an astronaut, right? Okay. And y'all know that Halloween is coming up, right? And next week on Sunday, we're going to have trunk or treat from 4 to 6 in the parking lot. And we'll have hot dogs and hay rides and a train ride and a cakewalk and all kinds of games. So I hope everybody can come and tell your friends. And if there's any grown-ups that want to help, talk to me. So the reason I'm dressed up today is kind of partially because I wanted to remind you of trunk or treat, right? Because we like to dress up around Halloween. We dress up for like trunk or treat. And when we do that, we are imitating something or someone, right? Like, so this morning, I was imitating an astronaut, okay? So imitate is, the word means to act like someone or to follow the example of someone, right? So who are you guys imitating this year for Halloween? I'm curious. M&M's, good, I like it. The whole family, I hear. M&M's, I like it. What about you guys?
I'm dressing up as one of the Sanderson sisters.
The Sanderson sisters, okay, I like it. And Olivia's going to be a superhero, I think, right? Okay. So at Halloween time, we think about imitating people. So sometimes we imitate like superheroes. Sometimes we imitate candy, right? Sometimes it's usually something or someone that we like or we look up to, or there's something about them that we think is really cool or special, right? So do you know that there's people in our lives, not just at Halloween, right, that we imitate, that we follow their example? Can you think of some people in your life that you do that about?
Jesus.
Hey, high five. Yes, ma'am. Good job. Very good. Yeah, absolutely. Jesus, all of us, everyone in this room, everyone that's a Christian, that's our goal, right, is to imitate Jesus, to follow Jesus. But there's also people around us in our lives that we are, that we start trying to imitate, right? Some of those people we get to choose, right? So some of those people, like our friends, we get to choose who are our friends, who we hang out with, who we spend time with, because those kind of people there are examples to us. Sometimes they're good examples. Sometimes they're not, right? So we get to pick some of those people, right? Obviously, our parents are examples for us, right? Our teachers are examples for us. So the Bible talks about how important it is to look at the people around us and decide who we want to imitate, who we want to let be our examples, right? So in 1 Thessalonians, it says, chapter 1, verse 6, this is Paul writing a letter to the Thessalonians. He said, "And you became imitators of us and of the Lord." So he was talking about this early church and how they were copying Paul and his other Christians because they wanted to be Christians too. They wanted to know what that was like, and they wanted to follow their good example. So I want you to think about two things this week. Look at who you're following. Look at who you're watching and copying, okay? And then also, look for ways that you can be an example, that you could be a good influence for other people, right? There's one more verse I want to read. It's 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12. And some of you, I think, know this verse. So if you know it, say it with me. "Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity." Good job. You guys are examples too. Yeah, you have a lot of power to show other people who Jesus is, right? Let's do that this week and every day, okay? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for being our example of how to live, of how to make good choices, of how to love others. And please help us to be a good example too. In Jesus' name, amen.
As I mentioned earlier, this is the time of year when we do our stewardship campaign, where we focus ourselves on our commitments to God and looking toward the new year so that we can be the church God has called us to be and to do the things that God has called us to do as stewards of His good resources. God has given us everything that we need. Everything that we have is a gift from Him. And so we are what we call stewards of these things. It's our responsibility to shepherd them in ways that bring glory to God and honor Him as a way of, as an act of discipleship. And so when we talk about stewardship, we're not just talking about financial commitments, but we're also talking about commitments to our prayer life, commitments to service in and through the church, and many other various ways that God calls us to be stewards. And so over the next several weeks, you're going to be hearing some different things about what's going on in the life of the church and what you are committed to and what you're a part of in the body of faith called Methodist here in Buller, Texas. We do have a theme verse for this year's stewardship campaign. It comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 43, verse 19, which says, "See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland." God is continually doing a new thing in people's lives, bringing people to Christ, bringing new people into our community of faith, challenging us with new ministries, new ways of reaching out, new ways of being a part of His kingdom's work here on earth. And so I pray that during this time that you would be prayerful about this stewardship campaign and think about your commitments to God and this church in the new year. We will have a commitment Sunday on November the 12th. This is where we bring forward our commitment cards that are our commitments for the new year. That's going to be a combined service, as I mentioned earlier. And we're doing that so that we can have a shared light lunch together afterwards to celebrate. It's hard to do that light lunch when you've got a church service that meets earlier and one meets later. So if we have a combined service, we can all go over to the Family Life Center after that and participate in that. So hopefully by now you've already received a letter from our stewardship chairperson, which is Tammy Woodard. She was unable to be with us here today and asked me to speak about this campaign. And a little bit later on, you'll be receiving a letter from me as well. So please be in prayer for considering your commitments for the new year. And thank you so much for all you do to help us be the church that God has called us to be. I believe God is doing a great work in the life of Buller Methodist Church, and God will continue through your faithfulness to do that good work. Amen? Amen? Amen. This time I invite Jason to come forward and share with our affirmation of faith.
Let us stand as we join together in affirming our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
As we come to this time of prayer, I do want to remind you that we do have a prayer list that we put out each week. It's out in the foyer. I think we have them out in Harper Hall as well. We have them in the church office. If you need to email to you, just let Venus know and she can send you a copy of it. It is updated each week with our Prayer Partners group. Prayer Partners meets at 3 o'clock on Tuesdays, right after our lectionary Bible study. It's a good group of folks that are committed to praying for you and for the life of the church. And so we, every time we go through the list, what needs to be updated, what needs to be changed, and then we have to rotate some off because there's as months change and whatnot. So if there's ever a name that gets dropped off because it's been on there for a while, we haven't had an update or anything like that, you can always put the name back on if you let us know. But I want to encourage you to pick up that prayer list each week and join us in praying for each of the names that are on that list because they are represent your fellow church members, they represent family members, they represent folks from around the world that are in need of our prayer. So at this time, I invite you to bow your heads as we go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, prayer is the great privilege of the Christian faith. To think that we can approach you with confidence, the throne of grace, that we can come to you and we can share with you what's on our hearts, the people that we love, the concerns that we have, the worries and anxieties that tend to consume us, that all of these things we can share with you and you listen to us, you hear us, you care about these concerns. No concern is too small for you, Lord. No concern is too great. And we thank you that you are a God who gives each and every one your attention. And you act and react in response to those prayer requests, Lord. Thank you so much. May we become an even deeper prayerful people with the knowledge of your love and grace in our lives. Lord, we do lift up to you all those who are sick, those that are dealing with cancer, those that are struggling with family crises, be it financial, health, or otherwise. We pray for those who are lost and in need of you as Savior, Lord. We pray for those who feel alone in whatever it is that is consuming them. We pray for those that are grieving, those that are hurting, those that need healing. And we thank you, Lord, that you know them even better and more intimately than we do, and your heart for them is even greater than ours. And so we come to you with confidence as we lay these folks into your arms of love and care. And Father, we pray for ourselves that you would forgive us of our sins. We confess to you, Father, that we don't live always as we should. There are mistakes that we make. There are sins that we commit. And for these, oh Lord, we are sorry, and we ask for your forgiveness, Father. Free us from any chains, any addictions, any sinful habits that hold us back from being the people you've called us to be. Free us so that we might run this race with perseverance, with our eyes on the prize, which is Jesus, and with our hearts filled with your love, so that others may see that love in us and come to know the saving love of Jesus Christ offered to them freely through your Son Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Will you stand with me, please, as we sing, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian.
Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my heart. In my heart,
Gracious Heavenly Father, we are thankful to gather in your house again this Sunday morning to worship you, to glorify you, to praise your name. Lord, we give you thanks for the gifts and talents and blessings you've given us. We give you thanks for the blessings you've given this church, Lord, and this church family. We thank you for those who volunteer, those on our staff, our pastor and his family. We are greatly blessed and thank you for that. Lord, we pray that you would, as we return some of our finances to you, you would bless them to service throughout your world according to your will. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
God, from whom all blessings flow, praise him, all creatures here below, praise him above, ye heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated.
Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down
from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Let us stand for our scripture reading today. Scripture today comes from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Paul, Silas, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians and God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace and peace to you. We always thank God for all of you and continually mention you in our prayers. We remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, loved by God, that he has chosen you, because our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit, and deep conviction. You know how we lived among you for your sake. You became imitators of us and of the Lord, for you welcomed the message in the midst of severe suffering with the joy given by the Holy Spirit. So you became a model to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The Lord's message rang out from you not only in Macedonia and Achaia. Your faith in God has become known everywhere. Therefore, we do not need to say anything about it, for they themselves report what kind of reception you gave us. They tell how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath. This is the word of the Lord.
Be seated. Would you pray with me? Gracious Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight this day, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. This morning we're beginning a new worship series for the next several Sundays, and it's called Living with Eternity in Mind. This is part of the overarching theme that we have from the letter of 1 Thessalonians, where we will be basically dwelling for a while, if you will, digging into for a while, if you will, for the next several Sundays. Maybe you've been to one of these leadership things, you know, the workshops or maybe the teacher's in-service day, and the leader gets up there and is trying to help you think about goal setting and trying to get you to think about, you know, priorities or words to live by, and they try to do exercises, don't they? They try to make these things practical so you don't fall asleep on them. And one of the exercises that I've seen that these leadership gurus, teachers, whatever, do is they get you to think about what you want written on your epitaph. Now, when I say epitaph, I'm not saying that stuff that you take that makes you throw up. That's epicac, whatever that is. I'm talking about what they write on your gravestone, you know, your headstone. What do you want them to say about you at the end of your life? That's usually the question that they ask you in these kind of leadership training events like that. And so it's meant to get you to think about how you're living your life, or maybe what goals you want to have in your life, or what priorities you want to set for your life. And it's not a bad exercise, you know, to really think about it. What do you want them to write something about your character? Do you want them to write something about what your service to the world or to your church or to your family or how you loved or things like that? That's not a bad exercise to begin to think about how you're living your life now. But I want to say that it's a little short-sighted. That really what we ought to be thinking of is not necessarily what we want written on our epitaph at the end of our life here on earth, but rather what we ought to be thinking about is what comes beyond that. The life everlasting, the life that God has prepared a way for us to live in eternity with Him. We ought to be thinking about our life today in light of the life of hereafter. Now, the reason for that is because how we think about eternity affects how we live for God today. How we think about eternity shapes who we are going to be in the everyday life that we're living. So many times we're caught up in what is right before us, the screen that's right before us, the phone that's right before us, the tablet that's right before us, or we're caught up in the problem that's immediately around us, or we're caught up in something we did in the past that we're ashamed of, or if we think about the future, it's only maybe a week away or a month away, when's that vacation coming? We don't necessarily think about life in terms of what it means for eternity, so that how we live today is shaped not by the screen in front of us, not by the problem around us, not by the past that has been faced, we've been faced with, or maybe what's going to happen next week, but rather our life is to be shaped by eternity, so that how we live our lives is different because of how we view life in light of eternity. The book of 1 Thessalonians is a letter written by the Apostle Paul to the church at Thessalonica. Now say that three times fast. It's one of the earliest written books in the New Testament, providing a glimpse into the early church and into Paul's teaching. And the central theme of it is living in light of the second coming of Jesus Christ, which is that which ushers in eternity for us. Paul encouraged the Thessalonians to remain faithful amid persecution. Well, he does encourage us as well. Don't let me get that wrong there. He's encouraging, writing to the church at Thessalonica, encouraging them to remain faithful amid persecution and to live a life pleasing to God. He speaks to them about several different topics. He speaks to them about the topic of sexual immorality. He talks to them about a work ethic. He talks to them about how to live within the body of Christ as a community of faith. And in addition to all this, he also provides us with an overview of what the Christian faith is all about. He speaks about the importance of faith, hope, and love. And he also teaches them the importance of prayer, the importance of worship, and living lives of thanksgiving. Now, overall, 1 Thessalonians is a letter of encouragement. It's a letter of instruction. It's a letter of hope. And it's a letter that's relevant not only to the original recipients of that letter, both young and old, but also to us today, both young and old. Young in the faith and mature in the faith. Those that are of old age, middle age, young age, whatever. This is applicable to us all. And as we live in light of the second coming of Jesus Christ, which opens the door to eternity, we can learn much from the example of the Thessalonians as well as the teachings of Paul in this beautifully written and short letter as a way to prepare us for what is to come by how we live today. Now, learning to live with eternity in mind is the sort of thing that shapes who we are. That's the point I'm trying to get across to you this morning. It shapes how we live our lives. Let's look at some of the ways that it shapes us. Number one, living with eternity in mind helps us to prioritize things that are most important. When we know that our time here on earth is short, and it is, really, when you compare it to eternity, did I bring the rope in here that one time when okay, some of y'all are nodding your head, yes. I didn't bring it with me today. I had a rope. They went all the way out the door and turned right and went out that way. And it was meant to represent an endless rope that went on forever and ever. That represented for us eternity. And on the very end, there was this tape that only was about this much of the rope, you know. But the rest of the rope went out there. When you compare your life and how long you're alive on this earth compared to eternity, what you have is a very finite, very short amount of time. And when you realize that in comparison to eternity, you begin to realize that we need to be thinking about this more seriously. Because that means that we have a very short period of time on this earth to prioritize what's most important. We began to prioritize our eternal investments when we began to think with eternity in mind. In other words, we think about what are things that we can do in the lives of other people that make a difference in eternity for them. So that might mean, how do we share faith with somebody? Or how do we make sure our grandchildren are going to church? Or how do we make sure we're raising our kids in church? Or, you know, we start doing things like, how do we share our faith with somebody? Or how do we, disciple somebody? How do we help somebody to join us as we go off into eternity with God? This leads one to spend more time with our loved ones, to invest in our own spiritual lives, to invest in our own faith, but also invest in sharing our faith with others. Here's number two. Living with eternity in mind also gives us a hope and a perspective that changes the way we live. When we are facing difficult times, it can be helpful to remember that this suffering that we're facing in this world, these challenges that we face in this world, they only get that short section of eternity. They only have a short period of time to affect our lives, because we're going to live the rest of our lives without that pain. We're going to live the rest of our lives without those tears. We're going to live the rest of our lives without that disease, because in eternity, those things aren't present. And so when you look at it in light of that, you begin to see, you know, what is our life in light of eternity? What is these shortcomings? What is this pain? What is this limitation? What is this disease in light of eternity? That shapes our perspective. That gives us hope. Living with eternity in mind motivates us to live a life that is pleasing to God. When we know that one day we'll give account to God for our lives, and we are more likely to try to live in a way that's going to honor Him. This can lead us to making better choices and to grow in our character. Living with eternity in mind helps us to become more compassionate and forgiving of others. When we realize that everyone will either spend eternity in either heaven or hell, we are more likely to be compassionate towards them. We are more likely to want to have them join us with us in eternity. And so we'll do what we need to do to share our faith with others, or invite them to church, or to help them to find a way to be in relationship with Jesus Christ, because we want them to join us in the eternity God has for us. Living with eternity in mind gives us a sense of purpose and meaning in life. Knowing that we were created in God's image and have a part in His eternal plan can give us a sense of purpose and meaning in life, and this can motivate us to live our lives to the fullest so that we make a difference in this world, because our time is so short. Are we wasting our time? Are we squandering the gifts that God has been given us? Or are we using them in the short period of time that we have 60, 70, 80 years, maybe 100, maybe a little over for some of us. Are we making the most of the time that God has given us? This morning's passage speaks of two things. It speaks of imitators, and it speaks of models. It speaks of us being those that imitate or follow the imitators, those that we are to imitate in our lives, but it also speaks about how we are to be models. Let's look at each of these in turn. In verse 6, Paul says that the Thessalonians became imitators of him and the Lord. I'm going to read this. It's not on the screen. It says, "You became imitators of us and of the Lord, for you welcomed the message in the midst of severe suffering with the joy given by the Holy Spirit." You know, Paul is saying to them, listen, you have done a great work. You have become a great church because you're following the examples of those that God has placed in your path to help you along the way, while at the same time, you're being an imitator of the one who we are all to follow, which is Jesus Christ. You know, Paul was a great example to follow. His life was worth imitating in so many ways. He was a man who was wholly devoted to Jesus Christ and the good news. He was a man of great love and great compassion and great humility, and I would say great perseverance. He did not give up in sharing the gospel wherever he had the opportunity to do that. And he faced great hardships in doing that through his missionary journeys. He went from place to place sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. He was committed to the discipleship of the Christians that were converted in the churches that he started. He wanted to know that they were saved, but he also wanted to know that they were living for Jesus. And he sought not his own glory or recognition, but in a humble and a selfless way, he always seemed to put others before himself as he constantly and consistently pointed others to Jesus Christ. He was forgiving, he was compassionate, he was joyful, he was hopeful. Paul's life is a shining example of what it means to be a faithful follower of Jesus Christ who lives in light of eternity. How wonderful it was for this young church in Thessalonica to have someone like Paul, someone like Silas, someone like Timothy to stand before them and to bear witness to them of what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Paul's life was a shining example of what that meant to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And Paul did that on purpose. Paul lived his life in a very intentional way, not so that he could point people to Paul, but for the sole purpose of pointing others to Jesus Christ. Listen to what he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. He says, "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ." Who has been your Paul in your life? Who's been that person that you have looked up to spiritually? Maybe your grandma was just a wonderful prayer warrior and you saw her prayer life and you have tried to imitate that in your life. Maybe it's your dad or maybe an uncle or a brother or a friend or somebody who modeled for you what it looked like to be a person of grace. You know they've received grace from God, but they are the most gracious persons when they give grace to other people. Who is that person in your life who's been the example of servanthood? That person that's always willing to volunteer. That person that's always willing to step up when the need arises. Who's been your example of stewardship? The person that's always been generous with the resources that they've been given by God, and they showed you as an example of how to live by giving a tithe or how to be generous with people who were in need to meet the need when it arises. Who has been the person in your life who God has placed in your path, like Paul was placed in the path of the church at Thessalonica? Who has been that for you? Give thanks to God for them. Say thank you, Lord. And look at their lives and examine those lives and study those lives and say, God, help me to be more like whoever it is. And ultimately, by doing that, you're going to be pointed to Jesus. Because that's who they are following. I think God puts people in our path like that because we need to see Jesus with skin on, you know? We can read about Jesus and we can pray and have this great relationship with Jesus that way. But God knows that we need examples in our lives of persons who love Jesus that help us to love Jesus better. It doesn't mean that those people are perfect. Anyway, Paul wasn't perfect, but they are for us shining examples of faith whom we are to follow. And may they be that which encourages us and inspires us to live a life of closer faithfulness to Jesus every single day of our lives. May they, like Paul, point us to Jesus. So that's the first thing Paul talks about. Be imitators. Be imitators. But he also says to this church, this young, really fledgling church, kind of newly started church, he says, not only are you to follow those that you are to imitate, you are also meant to be models. In other words, you're meant to be examples of the faith to others. Now, that sounds a little strange, you know. Is that something you say to someone who's young in the faith? Well, according to Paul, apparently it is. You see, in verse 7, Paul says that the Thessalonians became models for the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The church that Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians is really a brand new church. It's founded on his second missionary journey. Paul stayed there with Silas and Timothy for about 3 weeks until they were run off by the Jewish group that was persecuting them. In the time that he had with them, he helped to bring converts to the faith. He helped to disciple young persons of faith, helped to set up the leadership of that church. Despite the persecutions that they faced, this little church continued to grow. And Paul was proud of them. He was proud of the things that they were doing for the kingdom of God. And we read that he commends them for their love, for their joy, for their faith. And in verse 7, as it says, their example to other churches. Now, here are some things that we know about this little church. We know that it was a diverse church made up of both Jewish and Gentile converts. We know that it was a persecuted church because as it remained faithful to Jesus, the same Jewish leaders that ran Paul and Silas and Timothy out on the rail were also still attacking this church. They were a generous church because Paul talks about how they supported him in his ministry financially. It was a loving church and a supportive church with members who cared for each other, but it was also a growing church. It thrived even as a small church to be what it was called to be and do what it was called to be. Yet even as a young church with young believers, Paul calls it to model the faith for others, to continue to model the faith for churches made up of Christians in Macedonia, for churches made up of Christians in Acadia. Continue to be a model. Even as a young person, you can model faith for others. Even as someone who's new to the faith or newly renewed in your faith, you can be a model for other persons. What does it mean to be a model for someone? Well, a model is someone who can follow, is an example that you give for them to follow. A model is someone who serves as an example of what the right thing is to do. You see, people are watching you. Children are watching you. The young in faith are watching you. Those who have no faith are watching you. They know that you hang out with those people called Methodists down there by the donut shop. They know that you have on your Facebook profile Christian as your religious affiliation or Methodist as your religious affiliation. They know that you talk about going to church. And so, guess what? Their radar is out for you. And whether they're young or old, immature or newly renewed or newly whatever, they're watching your example that you're giving them. And they're deciding whether or not this faith thing is real. They're deciding whether or not this Jesus thing is real by watching your life. In the words of the Baptist pastor and evangelist William J. Toms, you may be the only Bible a person ever reads. They may have never picked up the Bible, but they know the Bible is important to you. And so they're looking to your life to see if you embody for them what the Bible says is true. This stuff about faith, this stuff about love, this stuff about hope, this stuff about forgiveness. And they've never read the Bible, but they're not looking to it as much as they're looking to you. Are you living your life in such a way that if they were to read your life like the Bible, it would point them to Jesus as much as the Bible does? This quote reminds us that our lives are a witness to others, and that we may be the only example of Christianity or of Jesus that a person ever sees. It is a call to live our lives in a way that reflects Jesus at every turn, in which hopefully one day we'll lead someone into the life of faith. Now, how do we do this? Let me give you some practical ways you can do this, okay? First, be faithful in your walk with Christ. Make it a priority in how you live your life. May your walk and your talk match. May your posts on Facebook match your faith in your heart. And may add this, may your faith be deeper than just some shallow quote on Facebook too, okay? Be faithful in your walk to Christ. Be willing to share your knowledge and experience with others. This is a part of that investment stuff I talked about earlier. These are the ways that we can make eternal investments by investing ourselves, mentoring young persons, by pouring ourselves into their lives, by supporting them, encouraging them, by picking them up and bringing them to church, or by teaching their Sunday school classes, or all these sorts of things. We baptized Sean Parker this morning. Sean's 10 or 11 years old, I can't remember, and we did it by immersion in the gym. I'm still going to figure out how to get that water out of the thing, out of the trough, but one step at a time, right? No, I know how to get it out. I can siphon. But anyway, I joked with him earlier. I said, you know, usually when I baptize a baby or an infant, I'll carry him around, you know, and I walk around. I said, Sean, I'm not going to do that to you today. But I talked about the same thing I talk about when I carry a baby around, when we baptize a baby. Y'all know what I say to you. I tell you like it is. I tell you, listen, this little child's going to grow up in this church. And they're going to be looking for witnesses and models about what this Christian faith is all about. And they need to look to people that they can see who are loving and kind and gracious, but also forgiving and even imperfect, yet still following Jesus Christ. Even though struggling and facing trials and tribulations in their life, they still have a strong faith. They need to see such examples. And those examples are you and me. How we live our lives can be an investment into those who are younger and those who are younger in the faith. So be willing to share your knowledge and your experience with others. Be forgiving and compassionate. When we make mistakes, we should apologize and ask for forgiveness. We should be compassionate towards others when they make mistakes. We can be hopeful and joyful. Be joyful and hopeful so that people look to you and say, where in the world is all this joy coming from? And you can say, it's coming from Jesus, you know. Be kind and loving. I've already talked about that. Be patient. You know, we live in a very impatient world where people are all harped upon. You know, we live in a world where people are mean-spirited and cruel to other people. And they need to see kindness. They need to see somebody who's loving. They need to see somebody who's patient. Be that example in a world that is completely the opposite. At the same time, I want to say this to us as well. This is very, very important. I want you to hear this, okay? You need to also allow people to see where your faith interacts with your faults. Let me say that again. You also need to allow people to see where your faith interacts with your faults. What do I mean by that? Well, I mean that we're not perfect. I mess up. I lose my temper at my kids sometimes. Or I do things I shouldn't do, and we say things we shouldn't say, or we post things we shouldn't post, or we make mistakes. We mess up. We sin. And those eyes that are watching us need to see that our faith doesn't just go away, or we don't just walk away from it because we mess up. But instead, they need to see a person who even though they got down on their knees and they soiled their jeans and they're covered in dirt, that person actually humbly gets back up again in faith and keeps walking towards Jesus. They need to see that we need forgiveness. They need to see that we're sinners and in need of a Savior every day, just like they are. They need to see that when we mess up, we admit it and we ask for forgiveness. They need to see that when we you get the picture? They need to see that we're human and that we're forgiven and we're not perfect. And you know, the world's out there saying, well, those church folks, they're just a bunch of hypocrites. Yes, and so are they. The church, that's just a place where a bunch of hypocrites go. And yes, and that's because we're here knowing very well that we don't have it all together and we need Jesus very badly. And so they need to see us even in our imperfection. And not making worse mistakes, but rather realizing our faults and turning to Jesus and saying, Jesus, I'm sorry, I need you to forgive me. And so what they see there is someone who's real and who is authentic and may not have it all together yet. And then that's okay, because the Christian life is not about absolute perfection. It's about progress. One day at a time, maybe three steps back and two steps forward, whatever that saying is. But it's people who are living lives of faith even when failure creeps up its way. Does that make sense? I sure hope it does. You see, this life that we have is both responsibility and privilege. It's a privilege to be experiencing the love and grace that we do, but it's also a responsibility that we have to live this life as an example to others, as a witness to others, so that we might be Christ's ambassadors in this world who point others to Jesus. And as we live with eternity in mind, let us commit ourselves to imitating the greatest example of Jesus Christ, at the same time, by His grace, being those who model our faith for all to see. We don't have to have it all together, but we do need to keep walking in the same direction of Jesus every day. Amen? Let me leave you with a brief challenge. This week, as you're praying, I want you to pray a prayer of thanksgiving for the person who's been your Paul. You know, God put Paul in the pathway of the church at Thessalonica so that they could have an example of someone for them to imitate. Who did God put in your pathway for you to imitate? If that person is someone who has already gone on to join the church triumphant, this week I want you to pray a prayer of thanksgiving over that person. God, thank you so much that they lived a life that made a difference in me. If that person is still alive, you need to still pray that same prayer. But then you need to take it the next step. And that is, I want to challenge you to write a letter, to make a phone call, to make some sort of contact with that person that has influenced your life, and to thank them for being a witness to you. And then this week, I want to challenge you to pray for God to help you to be a better witness for someone else, and to live a life that models faith for someone else. And don't think that you're too young in doing that. He asked a brand new church of brand new Christians to do that. Do not let them look down on you because you are young, Paul told Timothy. But be a model in your faith for others. So ask God, Lord, is there ways that I can do this better? Help me by your grace to do that. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all said together? Amen. Our closing song this morning is Lead Me, Lord. If you're here this morning and God is moving your heart and life and you're ready to profess faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior for the first time, or if you need to take a time to renew your faith in Christ, you're invited to come forward and let us celebrate that with you this morning. If you have already done that and you're interested in becoming a member of this church, that's something we do certainly want to sit down with you and talk to you about the mission and vision of this church, talk to you about how you can get plugged into that. That's something I like to set up a time for us to do, and we can meet at your convenience. So give me a call this week at the church office, and we can sit down and do that. If there's something from this message today or from this worship service today that has moved you and you need a little time with the Lord this morning, the altar is open. Come and pray. If you'd like me to pray with you, just indicate, and I'll be glad to do that with you. Let us stand together as we sing our closing song, Lead Me, Lord. This being a witness for Christ was left up only to perfect people. There's not a single person in this room that could do it. Amen? Amen. And so we live in grace, and we extend that grace to others. Go forth in the power and strength that God gives you to be the children of God, to lead lives by that power and strength that point others to Jesus. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace.